Do diabetics need insulin, including all type 2s? Is this master hormone something to fear, or under certain physiological circumstances becomes a necessity and a lifesaver? There are proactive steps, including lab work, one can do early in the stages of diagnosis to avoid the eventual use of this medication. But as you will learn today, that all depends on you understanding why you became diabetic in the first place. Welcome to the Resilient Diabetic. This is the channel we turn ordinary, struggling diabetics into extraordinary, well-controlled diabetics. If you are new to this channel, I sincerely welcome you. My name is Jay Sampat. Please don't forget to subscribe and hit that gray notification bell. That way, you will be alerted when new life-changing episodes have been published. And if you learned something new today, smash that like button for me. As with all my videos, this should not be considered personal medical advice. This is my interpretation of the latest research. If you want medical advice, please always consult your physician. When you hear the word insulin, do you picture a giant needle? For example, in the infamous pop culture movie, Pulp Fiction. Either way, most think of insulin as a difficult, painful, or potentially scary medical treatment. Little do you realize this is a vital hormone one cannot survive without. It regulates not only blood sugars, glucose in the body, but other very complicated processes. This master hormone controls not only the nutrients entering cells for energy usage, but just as importantly, it allows the building blocks, the amino acids or the protein that you've just eaten for repair and recovery of those cells. Simply put, without it, you would die. There are some very proactive doctors who put all their newly diagnosed type 2 diabetics on insulin. And then there are other old school doctors who believe diabetes is a progressive disease and will avoid the insulin conversation initially and maybe the subject altogether. They will put their patients on some combination of oral medications along with a given speech to what? Exercise more and lose weight. And that general advice leads to worsening diabetes and health over the long term. Who's right and who's wrong? Is there a middle ground? What if you had an early warning system, like 10 to 15 years in advance, that you are going to be a diabetic so that you could take the immediate steps to prevent the need for medications at all for the rest of your life? In order to answer these questions, you would have to understand what physically happened to your body or why you became a diabetic in the very first place. Learning how this model works gives you a huge insight. This is also so that you can make informed choices about whether or not this potentially life-saving therapy is for you. What are the facts and the fiction about insulin therapy when it comes to treating type 2 diabetes? Those of us like myself with type 1 diabetes, that is due to a late onset autoimmune attack which destroys the pancreas. That accounts for around 10% of diabetes. And we do need insulin. If you have type 2, which includes around 90% of the people with diabetes, you may not need insulin, especially, here's the key, if it's caught early. According to the CDC, of all the adults with diabetes, only 14% use insulin, 13% use insulin and an oral medication, 57% take oral medications only, and around 16% are able to control their blood sugars with diet and exercise alone. So let's get to the model first so that we can break this down into the simplest of ways. Your doctor may not even know this. Type 2 diabetes actually happens in two phases. The first phase, which lasts approximately 10 to 15 years, shows a slow increase in insulin resistance. That means something inside the body is not allowing insulin to lower blood sugars and is working actively against it. And what is that something? It is all the intra-abdominal fat that has accumulated over the years, along with fats in the liver, also known as fatty liver, and lastly, fats being stored inside that muscle tissue. What is critical to understand, these fats are not coming from the fats in the foods we eat, but rather from the overconsumption of carbohydrates. And it doesn't matter the type of carbohydrates, whether it's fruits, whole grain breads, cereals, juices, or even soda. Because of our sedentary lifestyle, our livers are actually converting these excessive daily carbs to that special type of fat that is then stored in all the wrong places. Why? Because there is no place to store all these excessive carbohydrates. The body's already full and has very limited glucose storage capacity. So it is not, and I repeat this, not the fat under the skin that you can pinch that is the cause of all these problems, but it is the fat that you cannot see that is building deep inside the body. This also explains why many type 2 diabetics do not look fat or look out of shape. This includes many athletes too, even professional athletes who've maintained a lifestyle of eating carbohydrates around the clock. Because these specific fats made by our liver work against insulin, the body, actually the pancreas specifically, has to compensate by continually increasing insulin levels. Over that first phase of approximately 10 to 15 years, even though insulin levels are rising, blood glucose levels will actually still remain relatively normal. But in order to keep sugar levels normal, that pancreas is not only becoming overworked and tired, but that high insulin levels in the background, which is also called hyperinsulinemia, is now becoming inflammatory and is destroying the body, causing metabolic diseases like high blood pressure, cancer, heart disease, arthritis, dementia, all the way to infertility. But then something suddenly changes after approximately a decade of rising insulin resistance. Pancreatic beta cells, these are the cells responsible for insulin production, are unable to keep up. And as this mechanism fails, blood glucose rises and rises quickly. And it only takes 2 years or so before type 2 diabetes is fully diagnosed. Beta cell production peaks and eventually starts to fall. Just like that car engine that's been pushed to extremes, it just blows out. The progressive decline in insulin production is often called beta cell dysfunction or sometimes pancreatic burnout. It is rarely discussed that your pancreas has the opportunity to improve insulin production once you've received your diabetes diagnosis, depending on how far you've already pushed it. Just like you rest the body from an illness or injury, your pancreas needs to rest. Continually consuming foods and beverages that are both high in carbs and fats causes extreme glucose spikes, which do not allow your pancreas to heal. Improving insulin production is a long-term solution for some. For others, once it begins to fail, it will continue to fail at a faster rate if the diet remains high in carbs. So in other words, and this is devastating, what if the medical community measured background insulin production first instead of focusing in on blood sugars? Because remember, blood sugars remain normal during the first 10 to 15 years. And they can easily do this with a glucose tolerance test with serum insulin levels being drawn at the same time. Knowing the insulin to glucose ratio, along with looking out for elevated triglyceride levels and low levels of high density lipoprotein, the HDL carrier, gives an overall picture of true health. Cholesterol levels, which they focus in on, are meaningless. And unfortunately, insulin resistance is rarely diagnosed in most medical practices. And this isn't because it's not widely prevalent in society, but because doctors don't generally order the tests for it. Instead, as you probably know, the doctors more often order the standard tests for diabetes that measure glucose levels, fasting blood glucose, and the hemoglobin A1C. One has to remember, doctors are taught to be reactive, not proactive, to prevent diabetes from occurring in the first place. And I'm sure the same story goes for you. Hello, Mr. Smith. Lab tests show you're a type 2 diabetic. Here's your bag of medications. The pharmacist will tell you how to take them. We'll see you in 6 months. And here is what personally angers me. You're left alone to figure out the game plan, not knowing why your diabetes happened in the first place. Because more than likely, you were not eating donuts and candy bars and bags of potato chips and sodas all day long. Why are you a diabetic? Then you have to navigate the most critical of questions. First on that list, is insulin really necessary? Your fears about insulin are justified, and you may be reluctant to inject insulin for various reasons, including you fear the pain of needles. And I'm here to tell you the reality. With the small fine needles that we have today, insulin injections are close to painless, if not painless. In fact, I would say that the finger pricks we use to measure blood glucose levels are far more painful than the insulin injections themselves. Second, you've got feelings of guilt that you've done something wrong all these years. Third, you've got the impression that this is the last resort, or insulin is forever. And that's not necessarily true. Some of you may need insulin temporarily, such as right after your diagnosis or during pregnancy, whereas others may need to stay on it indefinitely. You fear hypoglycemic attacks or low blood sugars, and that does happen from time to time. Finally, you fear weight gain, and this is big, especially if one is still eating a diet high in carbohydrates. What you must understand, once diagnosed as a type 2, blood glucose levels are now elevated and sky high. You're in that second stage. High blood sugars are now doing insurmountable damage to just about every single cell in the body. And this is when health goes down and fast. The point is to get those highly toxic blood sugars down into the safe zone by any means necessary. And in my humble opinion, where should that be? That is an A1C for all diabetics, including type 1s like myself, to be in that non-diabetic range, about 4.7 to around 5.2. Insulin is an effective way to achieve blood sugar control immediately, which can prevent or delay certain diabetes complications over the long term. Not only that, but insulin has fewer side effects than some of the other diabetic medications. That is because insulin is a synthetic version of the hormone our bodies already produce. Therefore, it interacts with your body in more of a natural way than other medications do, leading to fewer side effects. So now that you see the big picture, we can drill into answering the question whether or not one should take insulin for a short-term period or for life. And it all depends on two factors. One, how burnt out or how much damage has been done to the pancreas. In other words, how much insulin does it produce now? Second, if you get rid of all that intra-abdominal fat, the liver fat, and the fat inside the muscle that creates insulin resistance, so your pancreas doesn't have to work so hard, would insulin still be needed? The less of these fats you have stored inside your body, the less insulin you will need to take or the pancreas will have to produce. That also comes along with understanding two vital components. The diet you choose will either hurt and drive you into the ground, or it will immediately start healing that body. You will need a diet that allows all those toxic fats to be burned off. Second, and most critically for your life expectancy, helps keep or build muscle tissue, because it is that muscle tissue you lose as you age, and it is that muscle tissue that adds to insulin sensitivity, and at the same time, it soaks up all that glucose after you've eaten. Third, a diet that does not leave you hungry, starving, and miserable all day, wanting more carbohydrates, creating this vicious, unbreakable circle. Do you continue to choose a diet high in carbs, which still puts more pressure on the pancreas, causing further burnout? This is one of the big limiting personal questions you're going to have to answer, especially for those who are vegetarian or vegan diabetics. That is because, again, these diets are not only high in carbohydrates, but low in high quality protein. Always continually think of that big picture. What caused the diabetes in the first place? The human body was never designed to be eating carbs and snacks around the clock. Even the healthy carbs the experts still push on newly diagnosed diabetics. The body needs time where insulin has to be low. Our genes are wired for the body to use body fat, our own stored fats, as the main source of fuel, not sugars. The sad truth about diabetes? It's a billion-dollar industry. If you do this wrong, everyone around you will make money and profit off your diagnosis and suffering. From the food industry to your continued hospital visits, all the way to the pharmaceutical industry, they all benefit but you. The diet that has been shown to work the best on diabetics, including myself, are the low-carb, high-protein approaches. You must also realize muscle plays the biggest part in your recovery. The more muscle you keep or build, the better your blood sugars will be as insulin sensitivity increases. And that can only happen by exercising, especially weight training, along with a diet optimal in protein intake. Starting insulin treatment should never be seen as a failure. And even with the low-carb approach and exercise, one may still need insulin. Why again? Because if that pancreas is damaged from decades of excessive carbohydrate intake and is no longer producing any insulin, it's gonna have to be supplemented. Without it, your health will deteriorate. I bet you would love to learn more on this subject, so I'll create two links for you. The first link you will see is to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channel. The second is the link to the playlist on diabetic weight and fat loss episodes. So have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which are generally released weekly. Bye for now.